family, you're tuning in to the Jimmy Bonds podcast on Illadelphia Radio. Pardon any technical difficulties as we are recording live on the Zoom platform. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the show.
Yeah.
Jimmy!
Lights, camera, action. Some people thought I quit and I ain't giving satisfaction. From a different era, writing rhymes up on napkins. What you had to say was more important, man, than traffic. Yeah, I'm talking back to, speaking of contemporary.
And welcome back to Jimmy Bonds Podcast and Illadelphia Radio. Remember, family, you can call us with your comments and questions at 844-844-1244. Again, it's 844-844-1244. You can also email us at jimmybondspodcast@gmail.com. Again, it's jimmybondspodcast@gmail.com. It's JIMYBONDS. podcast@gmail.com. And family, on this episode, we are discussing the topic of Black men experience. My brother Ty said we got to stop using the phrase Black. So we're going to say men of color experience, so we can make sure we be politically correct on our end. But we are talking about the experience. And I want to give this disclaimer, as I did in the first segment. This is not a show, a podcast about women bashing. That's not what this is. This is a podcast about us expressing how we feel through our experiences, and we pray that what we're saying comes across to the other side, comes across in a very constructive manner. You know, it's not, we're not picking on y'all. We ain't trying to make y'all feel smaller than anything. We're just trying to make sure you hear what we have to say. So, Brother Terrance, you know, during the break, you was going in. And this segment right here, we're going to talk about relationships, because I think that's a very kind of like the foundation of us as a culture. And so Brother Terrance is talking about some stuff. he said, this is why we go to the other side. You know what I'm saying? But T, go ahead, say what you were saying, bro.
I think that one of the things, the stigma that we always get as Black men for some of our women is that either how many kids you got, have you ever been locked up? And I think that's kind of distasteful, you know what I'm saying, to ask those type of questions. It's not just generalized as a conversation. It just kind of, it's a complete turn off. But when you talk to other ethnicities, and this is just a conversation, one thing that they ask, that some, not all, they will say, hey, did you eat? It's like, no, I didn't. Well, I cooked a plate of food. If you want to just come by, I'll have it for you and I'll talk to you later. That is crazy to me. Some of our women, now this is what I've heard. I don't really cook for men because it's really personal, but I don't mind, and excuse my French, fellas, giving fellatio. I'll do that before I cook for you. True story. I asked, are you serious or are you joking? No, I do that because it makes me feel in control. I said, what type of sick, twisted? I'm like, so I had that. She got two boys. And I asked, I said, are you serious? She was like, I'm very serious. This is what we're dealing with in 2022. And it's like, who said that was okay? Like, you don't think that we don't like to eat? I mean, I would like to get a plate of food, you know? But the other side, they do it like it's nothing. Oh, you want, oh yeah, I'll do that for you. It's not a big deal. And it shouldn't be a big deal. They make some of make it a big deal just to get a plate of food. Right. It's not even, well, what I do about if I meet up at a barbecue and you on the grill, it's the same thing. But psychologically, it's kind of like we're into that world now. I understand that women want to feel independent. That's great. Great. But you don't got to just be that way with everybody. Not everybody's out to get you. And I think some of them are. They feel like I'm like, look, I know you. And you know what's funny? I've always asked some women about their previous relationship. And they always told me what happened. Which sometimes I feel like, okay, well, what did you do? Yeah. And what did you learn?
Yeah.
You know what they say? I wish I would have known about this later in life about how he was. You didn't learn nothing. You can be better in the relationship. So you mean to tell me you don't think you did nothing wrong? No. I was like, nah, this ain't going to work. I don't got time. And this, I'm just talking about from an adult, being an adult.
Yeah.
Just an adult. I mean, real adult shit. And we have gotten to a point where as though you really think you did nothing wrong. You think the natural behavior of this other person was just, they just did it. And I don't believe that. Is your story his story and the truth?
There's always three sides to a story, bro.
Yeah, and the thing is, I wasn't even looking about telling about what happened. Just like, yo, what did you learn in your relationship?
Yeah, I mean, so me, Tammy, Kev, all the brothers know my situation. I am newly separated. Okay. I'm newly separated. I'm putting that out the world. So if you listen to this podcast, you know.
Congratulations.
I'm newly separated. And talking to Kev and talking to T, and as many times I've talked to T about this, all I hear is this ain't nothing but trash out here, bro. It's trash out here. It's not what you're looking for. And T always hit me with the, you know, Jimmy, you a good dude, man. You can't be out here with these women. You a good dude, man. You a good dude. And I'm a patient. I'm a patient person. I don't really, you know, I deal with one. I don't deal with many. I ain't got the time for it. I ain't got the energy for it. Nor do I have the finances for it to deal with many different women on a different.
Yeah.
Okay. So when I'm focused on one, I'm focused on one. You with me, we together. That's it. You know, I find it that even trying to communicate with women, they're automatically thinking you want something from them.
Mm-hmm. Talk about it. Talk about
I just want to be your friend.
And you know, sometimes
generally, my bad. Go ahead, Kev.
That's it.
No. And I think that they've been conditioned, right, to think that we want something from them. And I get it, but you don't have to give what a person wants.
No,
right. The most precious thing that you have is your body. And I've heard women, you know, let a man drive her car. She won't let a man drive her car, but she'll give him her body, right? So you trust him enough with your body, but not to let him drive your car. Mm-hmm. So you tell him what you believe that you're worth, right? And subliminally, when men, we know that, then we start to play those games. And like Terrence was saying, when you ask a woman about the relationship, they give you all the information. Every single one that I've talked to was the victim. I think I'm batting 1,000. Every single one. Nobody said, well, you know what? I should have cooked him. I could have done that. One example, I asked a woman one time, and when I started dating her, she invited me over for dinner. I was like, yes. I talk about cooking so much, like you said, Terrence. That's if you don't cook, you're not even in the ballpark, right?
No, not at all.
So she invited me over for dinner and cooked. I'm like, okay, cool. Let me tell you, that was a setup.
Completely, because
you know, her girlfriends were telling her, why are you cooking? That's not your husband. But yet you want to see what I can do. You want me to show you my husband qualities, but yet I can't show you any of your wife qualities. And so what I was trying to explain to her is that women want it for a title, but wife is a lifestyle, it's a character.
Yes.
So it's not a title, but the women, yes. I think a lot of women, and it's a shame that when we talk as men, we got to say some women, look, I understand we're talking about from our experiences, and more likely than not, the majority of women want the title, but they don't want the responsibility, and they do not want to do the work, right? And so the definition of love is not how you feel, it's how you feel about making other people feel. That's the definition of love. Keeps no record wrong, all of these things. But if it's just like when you love your child, you know, your child can say something and do something, that's an unconditional love. And I say all relationships come with conditional love. Because my condition is this. And so when we say I want an unconditional love, to me it doesn't exist with a significant other. Because if you cheat on me, that's the condition, we die.
Yeah, plain and simple. Like there is nothing else that you can do. Okay. You cross that boundary, particularly if I ain't cheating on you. And I'm being loyal. And I'm being faithful. You know what I mean? They throwing panties at me, but I'm not paying no attention to it. You understand what I'm saying? Like they for some reason, that's not a value.
You know what's scary?
That's not important, bro. What's scary, T?
You know what's scary? Like when I hear these, you know, some women talk about their previous relationship and how the guys were, you kind of almost say like, well, why was you talking to somebody like that? What you thought that was going to change? It's kind of like, because you told me that, and because of a good person that I am, it's kind of like, what did you honestly think that she was going to get out of it? You can't possibly think she's going to get a relationship out of it. You can't possibly think she's going to get a husband out of it. You know what I'm saying? And it's kind of like you sit and you hear these things. It's like, wow, man. I mean, I'm talking about professors. I'm talking about doctors. I'm talking about lawyers, Jim.
Therapists, right?
Therapists. Remember the lawyer girl?
No, she's not a lawyer, bro. She's an attorney.
She told me she was an attorney. an attorney. The first thing she said, what'd she say, Jim? She said, oh, I want to go to Fleming. I'm like, what makes you think I'm going to take you to Fleming's?
Right. No. She automatically, and that's the other kicker of it. Like, you automatically think that we're just going to spend money on you because you have a vagina. That's what you think in your mind.
Entitled.
Somebody taught you, somebody told you this. Somebody told you that this is the way a man is supposed to treat you. You know, end of the day.
You got to earn that.
Yo, you have to earn it. If you have to earn it. You got to earn it. Just like we got to earn it, you got to earn it. And if you're wondering why we're talking like this, because this is what we've been experiencing. This is what brothers out here are going through every day. I mean, good brothers. I'm talking about the knuckleheads that we know that are out there. You know what I mean? Here's an example. You'll find a woman that will, she'll date a dude with five baby mamas. And you'll sit there like, why are you even, why are you even dealing with that? Now, I'm not saying he's not a good dude, but what'd you say, Ty?
No, I was going to say the images are implanted in their head to look for those type of men. Like, again, everybody on this panel say, you know, I'm a good dude. No, they've been told they're good guys. But the images that are out there for the women are not good guys. They want you to talk to them like you DMX. You know what I mean?
You know what I mean? Get over it.
So,
I mean, shut up.
What you're saying, I've been doing it all wrong. I get you now. Okay.
You see what I'm saying? No, seriously. No, I mean,
you have. No,
it's the images that are put out there.
No, we've been doing it all wrong. We should go around, excuse my French, calling them bitches. That's what we should do. We should go around saying that because according to my experience, that's what they want. They don't want somebody that's loyal and honest and truthful to them. They want somebody that's going to smack them up and call them names and treat them bad. Because
they're looking for security. The good guy, they have a hard time having a conversation with a good guy, but that DMX talking dude, they see security. He can protect me. He can pay for some bills. He can do things. Although a good guy can do it too, but the images that are put out there are not of good men, are not good, strong quality men.
I agree with that 100%.
Those images are not out there. So the only thing that they're getting is the images of negative behavior and characteristics from men. And that's what they're looking for. And when a good guy comes along, they're like, nah, I can't really hold a conversation with you. I can't deal with you on that level because my images of a man is this right here. You trying to build a family, do shit right, make sure the bills is paid on time. I'm trying to go places. I need some red bottom shoes. Little Ray Ray needs some sneakers. They focus on that type of stuff. You know what I mean? Kwame's dad not around. So are you going to help me take care of Kwame? Because his dad is not around.
I'm trying not to laugh, man. So, you know, I was trying not to laugh, but here's the funny thing about that. So if we're again talking about being on an equal playing field, that includes not just the work environment, that includes dating as well, right? Yeah. So if you're telling me as a man that it's my responsibility to finance the outing, the date, then I should make more money than you, right? Because if I take a woman out 1 week, $100, nothing happens of it. That's $200 washed. Now I got to meet another woman to take her out. $150, $200. I'm $400 in right now and have nothing to show for. You know what I'm saying? So think about it. I'm $400 in. So
should we ask for a stipend?
That's what I'm saying. Should we ask for a stipend in our pays? You know, if you're a single brother, should I get more money? Because if you think you're entitled to my money, I go to work and work. It's just that. But what I ask of you, you don't have to give. You don't have to pay anything.
Nah.
Right. And I remember one time I was telling a young lady, I was like, yeah, you know, I like coffee dates. I'm a coffee fanatic. Right. So I like coffee dates. One, because it gives us an opportunity to have a dialogue. Right. I'm big on communication.
Yeah.
So I don't drink coffee. I said, oh, they have tea. They have lattes. They have soda, Pepsi, whatever you want. They have that. I don't do that. I think that the man is cheap when he does that.
I see.
Cool. Have a good day. You know, because
you know what? And this, I'm glad you brought that up, Kev. So I talk about this a lot. When I first go out and go on a date, I always meet up in the daytime. I do it in the daytime because, for one, I still got my day and you got yours. You know what I'm saying? So that way we can meet up, like you said, have dialogue. I don't know how you are if we go out at night. You know what I'm saying? And I don't know what you're wearing. So this way.
Keep it neutral.
Right? I could just come, you know, meet up with you. See if we got connection together, and then we can work our way towards the nighttime.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Because we all know you go out at night, it's crowded, drinks are sloppy. Yeah. You know, it's too much going on.
It is.
You know, daytime everything is quiet, and I can still go about my day and do other things while you think about me.
Yeah, exactly.
Why they think about you, Terrence?
See, I'm gonna leave an impression on you. Don't act like I ain't leave an impression.
By the time
we done with this coffee date, Slim, you're gonna be thinking about me later on. That's what it is.
What you doing? You going? Then they gonna start texting you the YWD.
What you doing?
Yes, they will.
So,
yeah.
So try not to laugh. I was trying to keep it. It was the
weather. Hey, listen. You're right. We have to feel like we're, and I think a lot of black men, I feel like we don't feel like we the prize.
Nah.
I think that we just have to feel like either we got money, we feel like we have it or we don't. There's a lot of fools out there with money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It don't mean anything.
It doesn't.
Who you are as a person does. And we all know that.
But Kev talked about something that hit home too. You know, this whole thing about protection. You have to protect me. And now granted, Kelvin, I agree with you. You see a black woman, you want to feel like, you know, you don't want nothing happening to her. So, right. So something comes along, you are going to protect. That's just a natural as the men are, right? And the other aspect of it, of, you know, a lot of them, like, I want you to, I need to be protected. Protected from what?
From what?
Yeah. What do you want to be protected? So we walking out here and you starting fights all the time? Is that what you're saying? Like, is that
I need to know that you got my back.
Right. But, you know, got your back in what? What are you doing? What are you doing where we have to go get strapped? I'm trying to find out, like, what are you doing? Like, so, you know, that's the thing I'm always wondering. Like, they scream.
Well, you know what it is? Those are barbaric people. Those are people I always call them barbaric people. People that don't think rationally. They're tied into their emotions.
I mean, but here's the thing, though, Terrence. If you want me to protect you, guess what? You better protect me too. And I mean, right. I mean, protect me in every other way. It's a two-way street. Right. And they just, right. I'm standing out here in the front and, you know, you just being whatever. No, we protect each other. You know what I'm saying? It's a 50-50 split. If relationships was record labels, it'd be a 50-50 split. I get 50, you get 50. You know what I'm saying? If I'm putting in the work, you better get your 50 too. So it's one of them things where it's like, it always made no sense to me. And it also made me think to myself, who is telling you that you have to be protected? Who's telling you this? Where are you getting these ideas from? I mean, go ahead.
Ty. Those are the images again. Again, like, there's a science to relationships.
There is.
We were not taught the science of a relationship. And we definitely wasn't taught the science of marriage, because we didn't create marriage. That was created by Europeans and applied to us. You know, so we don't have those sciences. Sex is a mechanism that's used for control, you know, and if you don't understand how that mechanism works, you're going to run into problems. We're brought up, and it's crazy because we come from women. Women raise us, but they can't teach us how to be a man to another woman.
And that's what you say to all the time, T? No,
so how are we supposed to learn this? How are we supposed to know how to treat a woman and protect a woman and provide for a woman? We need to see another male role model or image do that, and we take and learn from that. They take those images away from us, and we're left on our own for the most part. I mean, the same thing applies to a woman. When they're coming up, they're not taught to treat a man as a man, respect him, and do for him. I'm going to give you a quick example. When I worked at QC, they had a temp agency there, and all the people were from Zimbabwe. I fell in love with the women's voices, their accent. I was crazy the way they said my name, right? So one day they in the kitchen, they be like, Tyrone, come here for a minute, Tyrone, come here. I said, what's up, y'all? What's up? Right, I just love them, right? What's up? We don't understand your women here. We take our checks and we take it home to our man and say, what can you do for the family? I said, what? So I'm chasing them all over the building now, you know what I mean? Like, I'm like, no, y'all don't do this. But I saw it firsthand for myself because I was close with a couple of them, right? So I went to their house one weekend, just, you know, chilling, talking to the husband and her before she went to work. So she leaves out for work. You know, he says bye and everything. So he's like, yeah, Tyrone, I just sit here in constant. She does all the work, man. This is beautiful, man. Why do you work so hard? And I'm looking like, damn, something wrong, man. Maybe I need to go to Zimbabwe.
Yo, for real, I mean? Right?
But it's the environment.
It is.
Our women are brought up in a totally different environment than some women in other countries. You know, that's why, Terrence, when you were saying, go look in the other direction. If you go to South America, you're going to find women totally different than what they are here in America. They're brought up differently.
Completely different.
So let me ask y'all a question, right? And this has happened to me when even in my mid-20s, and it kind of bothered me growing up. So I talked to a few women, and they told me, they was like, you look like you'll date white women. So I said, well, how do I look like I did? What does a look like I date white women look like? You know what I'm saying? And I kind of feel like it was kind of like, it's disrespectful, because it's like, you know what I'm saying? Like, why would you say that to me? You know what I'm saying? Like, and it was like more than one woman that said it. So and I asked another Black woman that, and they was like, yeah, I can see that. See what? I'm like, can you tell me what is it?
Yeah.
It's kind of like they put these weird like things on. It's like,
See, when you try to rationalize something that's irrational, you'll be feeling the way you're feeling, dude.
Yeah.
I've learned that don't even say anything. You know, one of the things I was thinking about is that men, we have so much to say today because we've kind of held it in and bottled it up. Like, there's no platform for us to talk like this, to be very candid. No. One, I'm trying to tell a friend of mine that men don't talk about their relationship to their boys as in depth that women do, right? I don't need to know all of those things. You just know that that's my lady. This is what I do. She may have upset me with this, but at the end of the day, we're together, right? And so there's a lot of trauma that is in our community, in this our culture of slavery, right? Mm-hmm. Black men had to watch their daughters, their wives, and their mothers be raped in front of them. So we learned how to detach emotionally. And then we were used for sex. Because if the slave master had more slaves, so when you create babies, that's profit, that's money. And so then that trauma in our community continued, right? And so it just kept going. And so when Terrance was talking about cooking, I even used that when back in the day when the slave master would beat the slaves, that the women who were nursing would breastfeed and milk while they left them tied to the pole to suffer overnight. So that you're nurturing us and feeding us has more healing powers than they know. Because if you feed for me, here's the thing. If you're doing something that every other woman is doing, why should I choose you to be somebody, right? Because if I have to give you everything just to get a little bit, you're not doing anything different. You should come along, see what I got going on in my life and say, where can I help Kelvin at?
Yep.
Right. I see that he needs this area to be taken care of. And I tell a lot of people that, you know, they say that you're always busy because I got to do my grocery shopping. I got to do my laundry. I got to clean my house. Right. I have to go to work. So the things that I do, I don't have anybody else to help me out. So that's why my time is very important. And I'm going to be honest. I'm not really trying to go out just to take you out just to have fun and go to a show. I had a friend one time call me. And she knows Maxwell. That's my dude. Right. Like, I love his music. So she said, you know, Maxwell is coming. She sent me a text. Didn't even call me. Maxwell is coming. I said, oh, good, that's good. I said, Maxwell's tickets are $375 a piece. I said, but I will take the lower tickets. Let me know the date and the time. I'll be there. I heard nothing else from her.
She thought you were going to pay for it, right?
Yeah. You was letting me know to go ahead and get. That's not going to happen.
That's cruddy, yo.
Somebody love doing that, though, man.
They do, bro. They do.
They'll start sending you vacation. But yeah, it's only $1,500 a person. You're like, oh, all right.
Okay. Oh, that's nothing. You ain't got $1,500? Oh, you broke.
Yeah, I'm looking you like, broke. What you mean it's only $1,500 a person?
Yeah, and you ever notice, here's the stigma. They look at a Black man that's broke as trash. But a black woman that's broke, oh, let me help her out.
Oh.
Let me take care of how whatever issue she has going on. She is precious. I have to find out why she is broke. She broke. She messed up her money. That's why she broke.
Like, so you know what I'm saying? I'm going to ask this question, and maybe you'll get some input. My question goes out that if women make the better parents, how come our school systems are suffering when most of the kids that are in school have come from one-parent households with the mother being the parent, right?
Now, you just said it, though. That's a stigma that women make better parents. That's a stigma. Because that's not, I can't even, I mean, I'm talking from experience. Like, I'm not even going to tell you, I'm not even going to go into my familial setup and tell you that it's not the truth. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to be like, oh, my kids love me more than they love their mom. Like, no, that's not what I'm saying. Yeah. I'm saying that there are some men who are better nurturers than their partner woman. That's just period. You know what I'm saying? That there are some men who are better at providing for their kids, taking care of their kids than the female is. Period. It is
patience.
You say what? Patience.
Patience. Patience with your kids.
Did you say patience? T?
Yes.
Did you say patience? Let me hold on. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. Wait. Did you say patience?
Patience
is something they seem not to have. They have no patience for anything. They have no patience. They want everything right now.
It's the TV, man.
No, bro, it's TV, it's social media.
It's the circuit.
It's the whole thing. They want all the attention and they have no patience. So you just sit there and you say to yourself, like, it's a lost cause. It's not a win-win. It's a lost cause. So that's why I always say if you meet a woman and you gotta know where you met her at in the state she was in, right? And I ain't talking about the state as far as land. I'm saying just like the state you was in. Was you drunk when you met her? Was you high when you met her? Or did you meet her sober and y'all had a good time and y'all was vibing? That's how you know that's real. If you meet a woman, you can talk to her for hours on end, and you can just talk to her. I ain't talking about come over her house and smash her off. I'm talking about talk to her. If you can talk to her and have a conversation for hours on end, and y'all keep the conversation going, that's how you know y'all connected. But if you can't talk to her, if you having a conversation, you start hearing things, the things start going off, the red flags start coming up, and you still talking because you just want whatever you want. Like, nah, bro, like you going down the wrong path, man. You going down the wrong path.
I mean, men make that decision real quick in the conversation, right? They do. We automatically put you in a box based off of your actions and the things that you say, right? Yep. And, you know, I remember one time I was dating a young lady and she was saying, how come you know, we can't like give the type? She was so big on the type. I said, I don't trust you with my heart. And that's because I saw some of her behavior, right? And so as a man, I have no problem in telling you, I need to feel safe too, right? My ideal woman, I want to be in a room full of people where I don't have to feel any type of way.
You know what I'm saying?
She knows it's not about what you look like. It's not about what you have.
Yeah.
It's about the love that I give. And I always say, my mom taught me this, that you're always the prize. And so one of the things I grew up as a single mom, she taught me how to be a good man to women, right? But my dad was absent. He did not tell me what a good woman was. Right. He didn't show me those things. So I was always looking for somebody and you know, kind of reminded me of my mom, not to take care of me, but that softness and that love.
Yeah, right? that nurturing.
Yeah, man, that is so good because when I'm sick, you know, I'll be honest. When I get sick, man, I'm about to cold blue.
I'm done. Yeah.
I'm like, I'm down 9-1, and then all I gotta do is push the one, right? I'm a big baby when I'm sick.
Yeah.
I want that woman to just give me some love on me. Because if you can take care of my house when I'm sick and take care of me and you cook,
so
that's for anybody. You cook for me, you got me. And again, I want to make this disclaimer. I have friends that are phenomenal women that are doing magnificent things, right? They've earned everything they have. But for the most part, most of them are married. And I'm always telling them, it's you, but you're married, right? So that, because men saw your value, they're going to lock that up. When we see something, I always say, if you think I'm going to see somebody who can add to my life, you think I'm going to let that go?
Yeah,
not at all. But if you on social media and you know, you're on Instagram, you're taking pictures, you're all out, you're drinking.
You twerking that every time I see you, like
right. And other dudes look, I'm a dude, so I know what's attracted to other cats.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to, and you know, they always say, well, when you met me, you know I was doing that. Yeah, so but what I was thinking was that you were different because you were showing me somebody else.
Exactly.
You were showing me somebody else. Now all of a sudden your girlfriend started to tell you, blah, 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 X, Y, and Z. So it becomes the girlfriend's club. And when we get together, I can guarantee you, if we was hanging out, nobody would say how much money I make, what kind of job you have, none of that. All we need to do is have brothers and just be vibing and clicking, right? Yep. And here's the thing, and I'm not saying this, we can be cats that are like 5'5". We wouldn't feel threatened by no other dude walking the street.
Nah.
So I don't understand, like going back to what is it that you need to be protected from?
They want a 6'5" dude. Yep.
Yeah. You got to be the triple six. You got to have a six pack. You got to make six figures and be 6 foot and over, right? But that's the mark of the beast. But I'm just saying.
Right.
But so you, and the average height for a man and a black man in America is 5'7". The average weight for a man is 192. So when you start getting into average weight for women, they will lose it. Do you understand me? They will absolutely lose it. Because I remember one time a buddy of mine was trying to hook me up. I was like, sure, there's no problem. Give him a number. We were talking. So she asked me my height. Gave her my height. I said, well, how much do you weigh? She said, oh, you don't ask a woman's weight. I said, so you can ask me my numbers, but I can't ask you your numbers. She's like, I think that's rude. I was like, so it's rude to ask you how much you weigh? I said, you're unhealthy and you're big. I mean, I'm just keeping it real. You're unhealthy and you're big. You know women by clothes. You know your size. Stop playing. Come on now. Oh, this is what I used to get. I'm going to get off this. I used to get, I'm kind of like Queen Latifah size or such and such. I don't buy clothes. I'm a size 12. I don't know what that is. How much do you weigh? They want to stay away from the numbers. And then, you know, I always get, well, you know, they had babies and this. And I'm tired of the excuses. Let me just say this for everyone that's listening. If you lose some weight, then we will wait. If you don't lose no weight, we're going to move on.
So let me ask y'all a question, right? So you mentioned, Kev, something about the Instagram, mm-hmm. right? And I feel like when women talk about the security and things like that, because when I see women on Instagram, I see what they do, right? Mm-hmm. They got their ass out. They got all this going on, but they want somebody to want them. First of all, do you want me to protect from the crap that you're doing on Instagram and you expecting me to be a part of that? Because I ain't doing that. You know what I'm saying? Because my thing is, if you on Instagram and you posting all the time and you showing your body, you showing all this, and you want, I'm like, I'm not, number one, I'm not going to take you seriously like that, number one. And number two, are you willing to compromise the person you with? And if he comes to you and say, hey, I think that, you know, some of the stuff that you putting on Instagram was a little too revealing. I just think you need to tone that down. Yeah. Because you're sending the wrong message. You're getting the wrong energy.
Yeah.
So now I got to protect you from the bullshit that you're doing. No, I'm going to leave you to the wolves. I'm going to leave you to the wolves. I'm not fighting them. I'm smart. See, the reason why I don't get in trouble, I know how to stay out the way. Yeah, I don't go. I don't look for nothing. Yeah. I ain't searching it. And if any woman don't understand that's the smartest thing that a man can do is think and stay out the way, then she's already protected.
Yeah.
You know? But if you go in like, yeah, I'm in here, yeah, this and that, you know, you asking for trouble, then that's that DMX guy. Then look, the DMX guy get beat up, you know what I'm saying? Then she get all smacked up, you know? And then meanwhile, the guy that was minding his business all the way down the end of the bar just watched everything. I see what happened. He came in, he acted like he was fly, was short, he was doing too much, people saw it, and he got beat up. That's what type of guys we are. And guess what? We leaving, calling whoever we up, like, yo, let me tell you what I just saw. This is exactly why I don't go out as much as I do.
Boom, yeah, real talk. Real talk, man.
You about minding your business. If you mind your business, nobody not gonna mess with you if you just mind your business. And some reason, some women love dudes that don't mind their business.
Yeah,
I stay away from them. Oh, this is another thing. I was saying to somebody, if I feel like any man that's married, if I'm around any married men, right, and they're together and they living together, and they start to talk about how they cheat on their wife,
I don't trust them either.
Come on.
I don't trust them either.
Come on, man. Because you're going to do it to me.
I mean, that's real hard. And see, that's the thing. This ain't just about women. This ain't just about us coming on women. Like, nah. Like,
no, we not.
If you a cruddy dude, I ain't banging with you. Just period. Yeah. Like, if your character says so much more about, like, the type of person you are, which means that you cheating on your wife, you probably going to try to steal from me at some point. You know what I'm saying?
Because
you cheating on the one that's the closest to you. Right. You know what I'm saying? You see, cheating on the one, you out here getting willy-nilly, bringing shit home, but I know for a fact that you can easily be the same person that come see I got and tell your boys and come rob me or whatever. Like, that's the type of person you are.
He's telling everybody. He can tell that he cheated on your wife. You don't know what the hell else he's telling.
You don't even know.
Just start telling your business.
You don't even know. And see, that's what I'm saying. And we're going to take a quick break, T, but I'm glad that you even said that, because a lot of people think that it's just one of them things where we're looking at just women. It's like, nah, it's relationships, you know, male relationships, platonic relationships, all of that. Like, people need to understand that, like, being cruddy and being a snake don't get you nowhere.
You know? Nowhere.
It don't get you nowhere. There are no rewards for being a snake. I'm telling you that right now. There are none. Absolutely none. I mean, unless people say, well, look at Jay-Z. Look what Jay-Z did to Dame Dash. He look what he did. And he got away. I was like, yeah, okay, I understand what you mean.
Jay-Z got caught.
Man, he did get caught. He definitely got caught, bro. He definitely got caught. He got
when
caught.
You get billion-dollar status, there's no secrets.
Nah. You got
especially a black billionaire.
Yeah.
What secrets you got?
I know. You say you did something, bro. You did something. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna say that for another time. I'm saying we're gonna take a quick break. Fam, this is the topic of the discussion I've been wanting to have forever. Okay. Like, you know, we do the professional Jones. We talk to people, bring them on and podcast and you know, interview them. This is I've been wanting to talk about this for a long time, family. So I am honored to have the brothers on tonight to share their experience and share what they feel and be honest about it. No cut cards, no trying to pivot on something different. This is strictly about how we're feeling. So remember, you call us with your comments, questions at 844-844-1244. Again, it's 844-844-1244. You can also email us at jimmybondspodcast@gmail.com. Again, it's jimmybondspodcast@gmail.com. It's JIMMYBONDS podcast@gmail.com. I'm Jimmy Bonds. You're listening to Jimmy Bonds Podcast, Illadelphia Radio. I'm out. Peace.
Fam, that's going to wrap the show. We want to thank you for listening to Jimmy Bonds Podcast on Illadelphia Radio. We ask you leave your comments and questions at 844-844-1244. Again, that's 844-844-1244. You can also email us at jimmybondspodcast@gmail.com. Again, that's jimmybondspodcast@gmail.com. That's JIMMYBONDS podcast@gmail.com. Now remember, family, we are still in the COVID-19 pandemic, so please, please, please remember to wash your hands, wear a mask, and practice social distancing. Also, remember to take nothing for granted and value every opportunity you have with your friends, your family, and your loved ones. For in these times, every moment is sacred. So until the next episode, you can find me on Good Hope Road, screaming, stay up, don't sleep in your dreams. I'm Jimmy Bonds, and I'm out. Fight on, come on.